The House of Light brings clarity to your soul, offering a safe space for healing through our compassionate practitioners, services, classes, and wisdom, plus the tools to support you in our retail space.
This is MJ Graham with Columbus Road Dragons, your home for Road Dragons hockey, Newnan 99 Rock.
Good morning. Welcome to WQEE 99.1. I'm Donna.
And I am Bruce.
And this is Lyrical Wisdom.
Good morning, Bruce.
Good morning, Donna. How are you today?
I am wonderful on this cool, crisp morning.
Very cool and very crisp. I agree.
Yeah, I'm really liking this little bit of chill.
I do too, yeah.
It's a breath of fresh air.
It really is. And surprising frost on the windows. Some describe them as snowflakes on the glass.
I like that.
The crystallizing. Yeah. Beautiful, like beautiful that. Designs. Yeah. But yeah, kind of surprising, but really not too much. I feel like if this is what this first little glimpse of winter could be, I think it's not so bad. I think it's rather nice.
Me too. I can take this.
Yeah.
I like it.
Absolutely. Yeah. And you cannot get past that beautiful sun out there today.
Yeah, it's going to be a beautiful day.
Oh my gosh, yes.
And we have a requested song.
Very exciting.
I love that.
Very exciting.
Thank you all very much for being here with us today and for listening to Lyrical Wisdom.
Yes.
You can send in your requests to the Lyrical Wisdom Show at gmail.com. That's lyricalwisdomshow.com. I mean, at Gmail.
At gmail.com. Sorry, Gmail. Guys, I joined in there and I kind of took Donna off guard there. But yes, lyricalwisdomshow@gmail.com. Please send us your requests because that is such a gift and such a beautiful, beautiful blessing and gift to us that there are requests out there. That means that we have people out there listening to us and we love you.
Yes.
So,
yes.
Thank you, Lauren.
Yeah. This one today comes from Lauren Grummert.
Hooray.
Lauren suggested Never Ending Math Equation by Modest Mouse.
This is a song that I've actually listened to, and I will not lie, because for those of us that have listened to Modest Mouse out there, I think we've listened to other songs that they've actually played, but this is one that is really fascinating to me, and I'm going to go ahead and start reading it.
Yes, thank you.
Absolutely. Never Ending Math Equation by Modest Mouse. I'm the same as I was when I was 6 years old. And oh my God, I feel so damn old. I don't really feel anything. On a plane, I can see the tiny lights below. And oh my God, they look so alone. Do they really feel anything? Oh my God, I've gotta move on. Where do you move when what you are moving from is yourself? The universe works on a math equation that never even ever really ends in the end. Infinity spirals out creation. We are on the tip of its tongue, and it is saying, we ain't sure where you stand. You ain't machines, and you ain't land. And the plants and the animals, they are linked. And the plants and the animals eat each other. Oh my God, and oh my cat. I told my dad what I need. Well, I know what I have and want. But I don't know what I need. Well, He said, where we are going, I'm dead.
All right.
Wow.
You ready to dive in?
I'm definitely ready to dive in.
I love the beginning because that's where a lot of people are right now in their life, I believe. I'm the same as I was when I was 6 years old.
Yes.
To me, that That is the epitome of shadow work, of what people talk about, all of their trauma.
Absolutely.
And their wounding.
Yeah.
And things that their belief structures, things that they do, come from when they were a very, very young age.
Oh my gosh.
And they don't
yeah.
even realize that part of the way they are as an adult can be a defense mechanism. It's things that they set up when they were very, very young.
That were established in the foundation mm-hmm. of their growth period through their mm-hmm. life. Yes, absolutely. These building blocks. They're like the those ginormous mega bricks in the old, old ancient structures. They've been laid there first, and then the other ones get built on top. It's all the other stuff gets built up on top. And I agree. I had a friend of mine who was watching the movie that was made, I believe it was in the 80s. I think it's called Stand By Me. And if that's the wrong movie, it's about the four little boys that okay. like go walking along like a railroad track, and they go off and they have their experience. And I think it's called Stand By Me. But he was saying that it's sometimes the best friends that you have throughout your life are the ones that you make when you're around 12 years old. And around those young ages, around mm-hmm. that time. And I'll never forget getting that text from him, because we were very good friends around that time. And we've always been friends in our lives. And that's the kind of thing that, you, like you say, you know, when you're very young, you have these establishments that are like the foundations of who you are and what you become. And the shadow work is going back and trying to kind of break those down again and reestablish what really it is that you were putting together. Because yeah. yes, we are the same when we are 6 years old, but then when we go back and do that shadow work, things change a lot.
Mm-hmm. Makes you feel real damn old.
Exactly. My gosh. I love that.
Yeah. That's... Yeah. I feel, oh my God, I feel so damn old. It's like, how long am I going to have to stay as this 6 year old that has been wounded, that has been hurt, that has been not loved?
A lot like a puppy sometimes when they are trying to find that forever home, you know, when they're just learning about what their world is giving them to deal with, and they have these established behavioral patterns. Sometimes it's the separation anxiety.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, I'm talking about a puppy. However, I'm taking that and thinking, you know, as a six-year-old, you know, as a young child, when you start growing up and you see these things and you witness these things, because it's amazing how we learn even just how to speak.
I was going to say, 6 years old is five is when you start, but that's when you're sent off to institutions to be schooled.
And then
schooled
that is...
in the ways of life.
I love how you just said that. We become institutionalized at a very young age.
Well, that's true, right? You just, go to school. That's what it is.
Yeah. It's going to school, children. It's just, that's funny. Yeah, it just, it is true. It's such an ingrained process in that way. And then, yeah, we are immediately kind of shipped off,
mm-hmm.
if you
mm-hmm.
will. Yeah. And
yeah,
then,
yeah. But you know what? There are some 6 year olds that had a happy, happy, happy life.
Of course.
And when they feel so yeah. damn old, it's kind of like, oh man, yeah. I feel so damn old. I want to be my 6 year old again. I want to go chase butterflies and, you know, jump off of walls and things like
yes.
that. That all,
yes.
you know, 6 years old can be a beautiful, carefree time of life.
It really can. And there are some, oh my gosh, there are so many out there, of course. It's just kind of funny because in the song, I'm the same as I was when I was 6 years old. And oh my God, I feel so damn old. And then moving into, I don't really feel anything.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of, you know, I think we all kind of can see that that could be, you know, from the six-year-old period to the older period to all of these things kind of sometimes wear us down to the point where we don't feel like we feel the things. They just kind of bounce off us because we get such a tough skin.
Mm-hmm.
We build up our tolerance and our abilities to just kind of in a way, our way of looking at life is fending off this world that we're existing in.
Right, and sometimes it can be in a very unhealthy way.
Exactly.
Where you don't allow yourself to feel.
Yes, and that's feeling like you're on a plane and you can see the tiny lights below. And that is almost like you're looking at the world from the outside, looking in. And of course, that is a good sense of detachment in some ways. However,
it's lonely.
It is extremely. Now, that is one way to look at that. That is just one way to look at that. But, you know, I really do resonate with the 6-year-old because I feel like sometimes I just want to be that age. You know? And that's what I loved about the laughter that you were having in that last moment. It just made me think of, you know, both of us sitting here like 6-year-olds trying to talk like adults. And oh my God, they look so alone. Do they really feel anything? It just feels like what we just talked about.
Right, right.
And oh my God, I've gotta move on. Where do you move when what you were moving from is yourself? I somewhat feel like Modest Mouse is basically saying everything that needs to be said. Right there.
Oh, so true. Yeah,
you know,
because I see this as on a plane. In other words, I know there's shadow work to be done, and I'm feeling it. I feel old. I feel like the time has come for me to have to do this. And on a plane, I don't really feel anything. I can see the tiny lights below. So many people separate themselves from those that around them that love them and care for them and all. But there is, and that is an unhealthy way to do it. Because then it's, they look alone.
They do.
Do they feel anything? In other words, you shut down to where you don't allow yourself to feel anything.
Absolutely.
But there comes, or I think there comes a time when going on that plane and kind of zooming out from what is around you and acknowledging all the other lights below. Are they alone? Are they also doing this? Are they, I call it going within.
I was just thinking that. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Because you got to move on. You have to move on from that not being able to feel place because it hurts, right?
Yes.
And then where do you move though?
Right.
When you're moving from yourself.
Absolutely. You're trying to move from yourself, but you cannot leave yourself.
Because the universe works on a math equation.
And that is true. If I get into the ancient geometry and the things that talk about the numbers and numerology and things that
you know what's so beautiful about this? Lauren is a numerologist.
Beautiful, because
this song is dedicated to her today.
Yes, and oh my gosh, what a beautiful, beautiful thing, because I don't understand as much as I would love to about that, but I do believe in it so much because there are certain equations that are just mind-blowing. And so the universe works on a math equation that never even really ever ends in the end. I just got that flipped. That never even ever really ends in the end. Infinity spirals out creation. Now, to me, that reminds me of the conch shell. Or
Fibonacci.
Yes, the Fibonacci spiral.
Yes.
And the actual, and that's where I actually go to when I think of these numbers, because the numbers that are associated with the Fibonacci spiral are also associated with the universe, and are
sacred geometry,
sacred geometry, and sacred or numbers that keep repeating in certain ways in octaves and in other sound frequency, but also in other numbers like threes and nines, and so that's part of this is just like it blows my mind to see this in song lyrics, because it's amazing and beautiful to think of these people writing these songs like this.
Yeah, and I believe what they're saying is when you have to move on and you know that you have to move on from yourself, in other words, you have to get over yourself.
You do.
You have, you know, and that is the fact that nothing ever really ends.
No, it doesn't.
So it's like this feeling of not feeling anything is never going to end.
No, it isn't going to end. And the infinity spirals out creation. The spiral begins with what could be equated to zero, the still point.
That's what I was going
to
say.
Oh my gosh, I'm sorry to interrupt you then. And that is beautiful because infinity spiraling out of that, you know, if you're working from trying to go within that bottom, that bottom, and it's hard to reach. It is so hard to reach because you have to reach that point where you go within and find all of these things and get down to that, probably past that six-year-old, to that point of that zero still point where...
Where you don't feel anything.
Exactly.
Because there is no thing.
No, now you're down at that still point of the parasympathetic state of kind of the beginning.
The womb of creation.
Exactly. And it just, it is a beautiful place. And there it can then spiral out the creation and then infinity. That's from that moment. It is absolutely infinity.
Because when you get to that point... Of the nothing, of the no thing.
Yes.
Everything is released.
Everything
is
gone.
So you can let go of all that trauma, all that, you know, everything that the six-year-old is holding on to that the six-year-old is afraid of, yes. is, you know, that makes her scared, makes her not believe in herself, all that stuff. I'm not worthy. It's gone.
It's gone.
And then
it's what I actually...
Tongue. Love that.
That's the thing. Yes, I was just thinking that. We're on the tip of its tongue, and it is saying, we ain't sure where you stand, because from that moment of release, then you ain't machines and you ain't land, and the plants and the animals, they are linked. It is like this moment of, that sounds to me like a moment of complete connection and bonding with all of creation right there in that moment.
Yeah, because, yes, yeah, exactly.
And I apologize, though. We are on the tip of its tongue, and it is saying, that almost reminds me of the word. For anybody out there.
The beginning was the word.
The word, yeah. You know.
And I was going to say, to me, it brought me back to what you were saying about the octaves.
Yes.
And the sound.
The sound.
The frequencies.
Because that's what the word was. The word was actually frequency and sound.
Mm-hmm.
It's not easy to say it was the word, but we don't actually know what that word was. Mm. But it had to be a sound.
Right.
It had to be a sound and a frequency.
Right.
And oh my gosh. But
because God said.
Exactly. Or maybe it was the great didgeridoo player in the sky.
Oh.
Now.
Yes.
But then they are linked, and the plants and the animals, they are linked, and the plants and the animals eat each other. Oh my God, and oh my cat, I told my dad what I need, well, I know what I have and want. And there is something to this that I know connects to the paragraph that we had just mentioned, and the plants and the animals, they are linked.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel like I'm... confiscating the microphone here, so I'm going to ask you what you think, Donna, quickly before I do it again.
Well, I see this as the fact that they've lost themselves in not being able to feel. They've, quote, lost their connection. And knowing that there is no end, that there is only the beginning. That creation comes from that still point of nothingness. It's reborn. We're all reborn. And therefore, when you're in that place, you don't know where you stand. You come up so new. It's you really do come back new going, what do I do? Where at? What do I?
Yeah.
Who am I? All of that.
I'm not a machine and I'm not land.
And I'm not land.
And the plants and the animals
around me. I see
the
plants and the animals, how cohesive they are.
Yes.
And the coherence, the sound and the frequency and the vibration that they connect with one another.
Yeah.
We all know this. How long have we known this? When a tsunami is coming, when, you know, bad weather's coming, the animals know what to do. They flee for the higher ground. They know.
They do.
They, you know, the vultures, when they, you know, they sense that there is food, they don't go and eat. They circle, you know, allowing that frequency out to anyone that's in the vicinity, another vulture, come, I have found food.
Absolutely.
And
absolutely.
They're linked. They're connected.
Yes.
So.
That is yes. And the plants, they are linked. And that is and the plants and the animals eat each other. That is the connection there. Because in some ways, sometimes you have to say, yes, you know, that animal right there, it's eating that plant, you know, really. I mean, that's,
and then a bigger animal will come and eat that animal that ate the plant. And then, you know, and we are part of this beautiful cycle of life.
Absolutely. That's exactly what I was just
really,
thinking.
We really truly
yes.
are. You know what?
Yeah.
It just came to me because it is kind of like, wow, where did this line come from?
I know, because then it actually,
but
you know,
I'm going there, Bruce.
I can't wait.
I'm going to go there. Are you ready for this, Ryan? You can shake your head. I know. All right. Here we go. Is everybody listening? Oh, my God. And oh, my cat. I have been being bombarded with information that cats are cosmic. They're from other planets.
Yeah.
So for me, what they're saying is they're reaching out to our God that we know here on Earth.
I'm certain.
As the Father.
Absolutely. I'm certain.
And
I'm certain of
my cat.
Yes.
As I am also calling out to the universe.
Absolutely.
The universal frequency of the all.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Because that's, you know, that's actually something that has been documented by people that have experienced astral and out of body experiences, is cat experiences within these astral or out of body experiences.
Yeah.
And that is remarkable to me, even within testimonies of people. I know everybody's thinking, oh, rabbit hole. But the testimonies of alien abductions, people have actually had experiences where they see cats in the room with them while this is happening to them. And they didn't have a cat before.
Yeah.
And so all I can say is that I truly believe that there is a connection cosmically, universally, and energetically with cats in certain ways. And I think a lot of people out there know that these animals are different.
The Lyran frequencies, you know, we're hearing all about these.
Yes,
and look at Avatar. I mean, come on. They're
absolutely
made to look like felines, cat-like almost.
Yeah, and I, you know, and then this is, the ending of this song really kind of takes me to where I feel like they say that, you know, they have that revelation, if you will, of, oh my God, oh my cat, you know, which is really beautifully put, now that you think about all of this.
Yeah.
And it just kind of finishes up with a kind of a, I told my dad what I need. Well, I know what I have and want, but I don't know what I need. Well, he said, where we are going, I'm dead. And to me, that's like, okay, she's, or whoever's actually saying the song, I put it as a, in a certain way, but I feel like it's like a, in respect to the fact that they're having a conversation with somebody that's, in our experience, as we sit here together, we are together here, but the Father in this song is not as together as we are here in this existence. The Father would be passed on. The Father would have already transitioned. The Father would have already died.
Yes.
And so it's such a beautiful statement, because then you go back to, I'm the same way I was when I was 6 years old, because then saying that to the Father, and he's saying, well, where we're going, I'm dead. So it's kind of like that's like the closure statement, if you will, because it's kind of like, well, I'm gone.
In other words, for me, it's also a part of that. I told my dad what I need, but then he says, I don't know what I need. And for me, what that is almost reaching out, what we all do on this human plane. We reach out for our creator. We reach out for the love that we came from.
Yes.
We're searching for spirituality, you know, to love one another and to be at peace.
Yes.
And I don't know what I need. In other words, I don't know how to do it here on earth.
Yes.
And so the Father answers with, if, you know, where we're going here on earth, I'm dead.
Yeah.
You know, so if you stay in this thought place of, you know, what people are referring to now, I guess, is 3D.
Right, yeah.
Then it's going to be hard to find what you need.
Right, no, absolutely. And
which is just that spiritual love of knowing that you are love.
It is. It's true. It is. And knowing that you are love and you are loved is also knowing that you can rely on yourself.
Yes.
And by saying, where we're going, I'm dead. I'm not there. I don't know what I need. Well, you're going to have to figure it out, because here is where you are. Somewhere else is where he is. It isn't really that person. And I know that feeling. You can always turn to somebody and say, hey, what do I do? What am I supposed to do? Well, in the end, in your heart, you're going to know, especially if you feel that love, just like, you know, that you know you are love and that you are loved.
Yeah.
Then you're going to know what to do. But there's that question, but I don't know what I need.
And for me, it's, I see the six-year-old.
Yes.
Just reaching out and holding his dad's hand.
Oh my gosh, that's beautiful.
And
absolutely.
Just getting up from wherever he's at, you know, throughout this process, and getting up and the dad looking at him and saying, where we're going, I'm dead. To the six-year-old.
To the inner child.
Yes. Because that child has to get up and face life on his own now.
Oh, beautiful, Donna. Oh, my gosh. These Friday mornings are so incredible. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And thank you all so much for being here for Lyrical Wisdom. We really love each and every one of you, and we appreciate you. It's because of you that we're here doing this.
Absolutely.
Right, Bruce?
Absolutely.
So reach out to us if you'd like to send us a recommendation.
Yes, please.
Yes. Lyrical Wisdom Show
at
gmail.com. Thank you all.
When you hear music, do the lyrics speak to you on a deeper level? I'm Bruce Thornton. Join me and Donna Wood every Friday morning at 10:30 a.m. on WQEE 99.1 FM, The Key, for our show, Lyrical Wisdom. Every week, we will dive into the lyrics of songs and uncover hidden messages that we hope will leave you feeling inspired and enlightened. We know that our ideas may not always line up with yours, so this show will be an open discussion. Email us with ideas for songs at lyricalwisdomshow@gmail.com. That's lyricalwisdomshow@gmail.com. Let's share some wisdom together.